Father, we thank you and we praise you. And Lord, we ask you right now in the name of Jesus, speak to our hearts, speak to our minds. Let something be said in this message that changes how we think about our work with you. Let something be revealed in this message that draws us closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you this morning. So good to see everybody. Amen. Oh, okay. I'll let you catch me. The way you tell me to watch out for my shoes. You know, I tie my shoes loosely. And sometimes they come undone. So don't worry about it. I'll be all right. Amen. 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 But, this morning, as we look at the passage this morning, we want to take you to the book of Galatians. So if you would turn your Bibles with me to the 5th chapter of the book of Galatians, and we're going to be looking at verses 16 through 25, and I'm going to be reading that to you from the New Living Translation of the Bible. So once again, that is Galatians chapter 5. And we're looking at verses 15 through 25, 16 through 25. And I'm going to be reading the New Living Translation, so it may be a little bit different than what you got in front of you. Amen. But the content should be the same. And as we read it, some of you may start to remember this particular passage. The scripture reads, "So I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are opposite of what the sinful nature desires. These two forces are constantly fighting each other, so that you are not free to carry out your good intentions. But when you are directed by the Spirit, you are not under obligation to the law of Moses. When you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarrel, jealousy, outburst of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these things. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have nailed the passions and desires of their sinful nature to his cross and crucify them there. Since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives." Amen. Our message this morning is entitled, "When the Holy Spirit Lives in You." When the Holy Spirit lives in you. You know, you can usually tell who is in charge of a church, who's in charge of a country, who's in charge of a corporation, because the character and the environment of that particular place will be somewhat similar to the person that's in charge.
be a loving environment.
You got a loving leader.
It'll be a strict environment. You got a strict leader. It may be a wild environment.
You got a wild leader.
It could be a deceitful environment if you have a deceitful leader. Oftentimes, the character of that leader is reflected in the actions of those being led.
I just use our country as an example right now.
When we look at the character of our government, we can see the character of the person in charge. We see lying, we see cheating, we see deceit. It doesn't lead to the imagination who's in charge or how that person thinks. Because when we look at the behavior of the government, we see that person through that behavior. The same goes, church, for the spiritual character of our lives and the spiritual character of our churches. I was once told by one of my instructors at United Theological Seminary, he said, when you look at church, you see the pastor. He said, you stand there long enough. This is what somebody was on. He said, you stand there long enough, people gonna start acting like you. They're gonna act like you. They're gonna think like you. They're gonna talk like you. They're gonna look like you. I said to myself, I said, I'm gonna be doing my whole bunch of already built to my profession. But spiritually, we see the church, the character of the church, starts to reflect that of the pastor over time. And we take on the character of the spirit that is living in us. Whether that be a worldly spirit or whether that be the Holy Spirit, we don't take on the character of the spirit that's living in us. And in Galatians 5, Paul described for us what it looks like when the Spirit fills you and it's in your life. And right now you don't have to raise your hands or anything, but if you've ever been filled with the Spirit, if you have ever been filled with the Holy Spirit, I want you to think back on what it felt like. Think back on what it looked like, what it sounded like. How did you feel when the Holy Spirit got hold of you and took over your life? And sometimes it's scary because you ain't got no control. And for those of us that got that OCD, we always got to be in control of everything that's going on. We got to, you know, everything. We got structure. We got content of every single thing that happens in our life. And with the Holy Spirit got a hold to you one day and took over it, you think you were in control of what you were saying. You wouldn't get control of what you were doing. You start shouting. You couldn't stop it. But now here's the thing. Very often, and nowadays, we tend to think that being slain in the spirit means that you start talking in tongues. Being slain in the spirit means that you fall out of your mouth. Being slain in the spirit means you take off and relax around church. Now that may happen. However, we have to be careful. Because see, what Paul describes for us in his letter to the church in Galatians looks a little different than what we think of. And so we have to be careful what we expect to happen all the time. Because sometimes the Holy Spirit is sitting right here with you. and you're looking for something else. And the Holy Spirit's in my head. When the choir was singing, Holy Spirit was all in that. You can see it, you can feel it. Did not know I'm calling out, the Holy Spirit sure was here. So let me share with you for a moment what Paul says. It looks like when the Holy Spirit is filled our lives. First of all, let me just take you forward to verse 17. Verse 17, Paul says, these two forces are constantly fighting each other. So you are not free to carry out your good intentions. That means, church, we want to do right. We want to do right. But it's a right fight inside of us. There's a part that want to do right, and there's a part that want to do wrong. And so sometimes you wonder why you feel like you're going crazy. I'll share this with you. It's just like I got five kids. And with five kids, somebody always fighting. Always. There's always a war or a scourge going on when you got five kids. Don't know who it is. I just ignore it. I don't even pay no attention no more. Because who's that boy in? Another one's going to kick off with every day. There's a fight. Fight or war with each other. There's always going to be a war within us. There's always going to be a fight within us. Because the good side of us is going to be fighting against the bad side of us. Paul provides a list of these two behaviors. One led by the flesh, the other led by the Holy Spirit. And in verse 22, Paul describes what it looks like. Verse 22, Paul tells you what it looks like when the Holy Spirit is in your life. This is what he says. But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our life. Your life is going to have love in it. There's going to be joy in your life. There's going to be peace. Let me repeat that again. There's going to be peace. Let me say it one more time. Somebody will speak. There's going to be peace. Take patience. When the Holy Spirit, you know, folks that got on your nerves, ain't going to be on your nerves. You don't see it, but you know what? You're going to just let it go on by. It ain't going to bother you. Because the Holy Spirit will give you patience. There's going to be kindness. You're going to be nice to people that you don't even know why. You don't want to be nice to them, but you're nice to them anyway. Because the Holy Spirit is living in you. There's going to be goodness. You just don't go around and do the good things. Because the Holy Spirit lives in you. There's going to be faithfulness to God. You're not going to have excuses why you can't worship Him. But you're going to always find a reason to be faithful, because faithfulness is what happens when the Holy Spirit abides in us. There's going to be gentleness. You know what I mean? All around you go crazy. And I like the last one. This is going to be self-control. Self-control. Self. You're going to get quick on our altar. We're not going to let stuff just try to come out of whack. We gonna get a hold of ourselves and be like, wait a minute, that's not a God, that's not how a Christian is. This is not what I see, what I expect to see a Christian. Let me get a hold of myself, and the reason why we can do that is when the Holy Spirit is living with us, we got self-control. But now,
look differently when the Holy Spirit is not in charge, and we do not allow the Holy Spirit to be in charge and to be in control of our lives. And Paul mentions that in verses 19 through 21. He makes a listing of what our lives look like when the Holy Spirit is not in control, but our natural desires are. And he makes a list of it, and it just kind of makes you cringe a little bit. You know, because as you read through, you know how you read through stuff, and you see you in there, and you try to read real fast. You know, and if there's too much you in there, you just gotta skip all the words all together. So I'm going slow. I say this, there's sexual immorality. It's there. Impurity. Lustful pleasures. All right, please, keep going. Idolatry. Sorcery. Hostility. Quarreling. Jealousy. Outburst of anger? Nah. Really? Is that what it looks like? When the Holy Spirit ain't leading at all, we just lose our mind one day? Outburst of anger? Unsuspected outburst? You sit there watching TV, and then the next thing you know, somebody just lose their mind. Outburst of anger. Selfish ambition, dissension, division. Ooh, Jesus, division, envy. Now, in my birth, I don't know what you were going to say. In my birth, the living translation, it says, drunkenness. Drunkenness! Drunkenness! And wild hearts! I'm going to do this to you. I don't know why I look like I'm not. But some people put over the wild part look like lays out this list of what it looks like when we allow our sinful nature to charge. And as a matter of fact, the list isn't even all conclusive because he goes like it. He didn't stop right there. He says, and others like it. He said, there's a whole lot of stuff, but not that all these sins that Paul is talking about, these are observable sins. I know I'm sitting here looking at it and said, these are things with Paul's. There are things you can watch, things you can see, things that you can catch, boom, just like that. But what about those things in our lives? What about those sins, if you will? What about those things that Satan uses to distract us, to enable us, to cripple us, that are just as powerful as those sins that Paul listed? They're those sins that are and others like this. And at not many ways, when Paul says, and those like it, that means that his list was also inclusive and that there's some stuff that we need to be concerned about. Those things that the devil uses to trap our minds and hold our minds hostage. And so, for a moment, let me just share with you some of those other things that the devil still uses to cripple us as Christians, but yet they are not as obvious as the list that Paul put down.
The first one that I talked about was God. Yeah. Yeah, see, and God's mission. Each one of them got a mission. That's why the devil sees them already. God's mission is to hide the truth from you. God does not want